So today we're going to talk about the ways in which a nonverbal behavior, and specifically one that we engage in automatically all the time in our everyday lives, can influence morality. And so we're going to be talking about mimicry and morality, to be specific. And so, of course, with this audience, don't need to define morality for you, but the distinction between right and wrong, and that one important component of this is being pro-social. And that's really what we're going to be focusing on. So pro-sociality really has, I think, three components. So it has an affective component, sort of your feelings, your emotions towards other people. They can be pro-social. There's a cognitive component as well. Your beliefs, your expectations, your thoughts about other people can be pro-social. And of course, your behaviors, your actual behaviors can be pro-social, helping others, for example. And all three types of pro-sociality are important with respect to morality. So mimicry, it turns out, plays an important role in all three types of pro-sociality. The affective, the cognitive, and the behavioral piece are all influenced by mimicry. So this is sort of our conceptual model of what we'll be talking about today. So mimicry can influence pro-sociality, the three different components that I mentioned, and with the idea that these in turn influence morality. And there's actually a lot of existing work out there showing this piece, that these types of pro-sociality influence morality. So we're going to be focusing more on this piece, the mimicry, the link between mimicry and these different types of pro-sociality. Okay, so first I'm going to talk about mimicry a little bit. So turns out that we mimic people all the time, and we usually do this without being aware of it and without intending to. So it's not like we go around trying to copy and imitate people all the time, but we automatically do it. And there are different types. So facial mimicry just refers to mimicking the facial expressions of other people. And we may not necessarily mimic the full facial expression. So every time we see someone, you know, wincing in pain or really happy, we don't take on the full facial expression. But we tend to mimic at least a little bit those expressions by moving the same muscles in our face, even slightly. So mimicking other people and their facial expressions. That's one type of mimicry. There's also emotional mimicry, so taking on the emotions of other people. So things like emotional contagion you may have heard about, picking up on the moods or emotional states of others. And this isn't, you know, so surprising given that facial mimicry occurs. You know, we're mimicking other people's facial expressions. This is one consequence of that, is also kind of catching their moods, catching their emotions. Behavioral mimicry. Verbal mimicry here. This is just mimicking the verbal characteristics of other people. So their speech patterns, their rates of speech. So if someone's talking fast, you'll tend to talk a little more quickly than you normally do. Even how, you know, like latency to speak. So if they pause a couple seconds before speaking, you'll tend to pause a couple seconds before speaking. Accents, so sometimes you notice that you may kind of take on accents when you're in other places. A lot of people notice this about themselves. Sometimes it's more extreme than others. So we mimic people verbally quite a bit. And then finally, behavioral mimicry. So this is mimicking the mannerisms, the posture, the gestures that other people do. So basically the motor movements. And this is actually what most of my own research has been on, is this behavioral type of mimicry, mimicking the motor movements, mannerisms, gestures. Although some of it is on verbal mimicry and even facial mimicry as well. Okay, so now Karina is going to take over.
Okay, so one component of pro-sociality that mimicry affects is its affective component. And what this means is that mimicry facilitates pro-social emotions. And the three types that we're going to be talking about, because there's an extensive amount of literature on them, is liking, rapport, and trust. So early research on mimicry focused on its relationship between with rapport. So these studies focused on interactions between people who already knew each other, such as clients and therapists, parents and children, and students and teachers. And what they showed was that people with good rapport tend to mirror one another. So for example, in psychotherapy sessions, it was found that the postures of the client and the therapist tended to converge, and the extent to which they converged actually predicted rapport. And mothers are more in sync with their own children than unfamiliar children, and within an actual classroom setting, posture sharing is indicative of rapport. But this is all just correlational evidence between rapport and mimicry. You can't say whether mimicry causes rapport or whether rapport causes mimicry. So later studies started focusing on actually manipulating whether mimicry occurred. And it was found that both mimicking and being mimicked leads to more liking and rapport. So for example, participants in one particular study listened to sentences spoken by two speakers with a regional accent. And they were speaking with the same regional accent, and for one speaker they were told to just repeat the spoken sentence, don't imitate. For the other, they were told to repeat the spoken sentence, but to imitate. And what ended up happening was then they asked them questions about how much they liked the other speaker. And when they imitated the speaker, they ended up liking that person more. Specifically, they rated them as being more socially attractive. They found them to be more humorous, friendly, warm, all kinds of good things. And this was particularly interesting because the accent that they had selected was one that was tended to be low on social attractiveness, that people didn't even tend to like. And furthermore, being mimicked facilitates liking regardless of whether that mimicry is behavioral, verbal, or facial. And it's not, even for facial mimicry, it's not about the emotional valence of the mimicked facial expression. It's not just that positive expressions, such as happiness, when mimicked, lead to more liking. Negative facial expressions, such as disgust and anger, also led to greater liking. And so we want to show you one of the kind of standard paradigms for manipulating mimicry. And this is a video from a clip with Alan Alda, and it kind of walks you through how this paradigm works.
I'm kept in the dark about exactly what's going to happen during my visit.
Okay, we'll have seats.
All Tanya has told me is that I'm to participate with Amy, a young woman I've just been introduced to, in a couple of simple tasks.
The first one we'll be doing together, the second one we'll be doing in separate rooms. So for the first task, you're going to be describing some photos to each other.
This is a black and white picture of an elephant. And in the elephant's mouth is a man's head.
Okay. This is a picture of a guy who's...
Now you can ignore all this talk about the photographs. What's happening here, although as you'll see, I wasn't aware at the time, is that Amy isn't an innocent volunteer like me, but actually one of Tanya Chartrain's students. And what she's doing while we're describing the photos is mimicking my body movements. Here's a black and white picture of men standing on their bicycles.
Okay, so that's how the paradigm works, and that's how somebody, we can manipulate whether or not someone's mimicked. So in this type of condition, so we'll bring participants into the lab, half of them are mimicked, half of them are not mimicked, and then participants are asked things like, how likable was the other participant? How smoothly was your interaction with the other participant? And what research shows is that being mimicked leads to greater liking and also greater rapport. So they report that the social interaction that they had was smoother when there was mimicry. And being mimicked also facilitates pro-social emotions such as trust. So what they did was interviewers approached people on the street and asked them if they would take part in a survey. And for half the people, they were mimicked. For half the people, they weren't. And for people who were mimicked, they ended up responding more to questions in which it was a survey on sexual behavior, and the questions became kind of increasingly more intimate. And they were more likely to answer these questions in the red box if they were mimicked than if they were not mimicked. So things like, have you ever deceived your partner? What fantasies do you have? And they were much more likely to do that if they had been mimicked. So this was presumed to operate through trust with the interviewer. And mimicry also facilitates trust in children. So children interacted with two experimenters, one who mimicked their choices and one who did not. So for example, children were shown these three animals and they were told to select the one that they liked the best. And the mimicking experimenter would always choose the one that the child had as well, saying like, I like that one the best too. And the non-mimicking experimenter would be like, actually, I like this other one. And so it created a situation where one was always mimicking them and the other wasn't. And then they watched as these experimenters looked at these two boxes and looked at the toys within them and had opposing preferences. And then the children were given a choice for which box they wanted. And it turns out, and they couldn't see what was inside, so they didn't know which toy they were going to get, but it turns out that children are more likely to choose the box that the mimicking experimenter endorsed, which suggests that children trusted the adult more who had mimicked them. And mimicry also facilitates trust in a negotiation context. So students were brought, these were business school students, they were negotiating the sale of a gas station, and one was assigned to be the role of the buyer, and the other was assigned to the role of the seller. And they were given some instructions on how this would work. So the seller was told, you can only accept a minimum of $553,000. The buyer was told, you could only offer a maximum of $500,000. And so you can see that this creates a difficult scenario where, you know, it's difficult because the maximum amount that the buyer could pay is actually substantially under the minimum amount that the seller is allowed to accept. So reaching a deal was going to require a creative solution. And it turns out that the seller also wanted to continue managing the gas station after returning from the trip, and that the buyer was indeed also looking to hire managers. So if they could extract this information from each other, this could help them come to a deal in which kind of the buyer could offer some salary to compensate for not quite reaching the minimum offer. And so half of the buyers were instructed to mimic, and half of the buyers were given no kinds of instruction about mimicry, so this was the control condition. And all the sellers were in the control condition, so they weren't told anything about mimicry. And what happened was, so the deal was considered successful if the buyer did not exceed the maximum allowed price of $500,000, but was also able to meet some of the needs of the seller. So allowing the seller, for example, to continue working at the gas station after returning from the trip. And in dyads in which the buyer mimicked, 67% reached a deal versus only 12.5% when they did not mimic. And also afterwards, they asked the buyer, you know, just to rate kind of how much did you mimic the seller? And the extent to which they said that they mimicked the seller, this also predicted likelihood of coming to a deal. But the most important part is that they asked the sellers how much they trusted the buyers, and it was found that the effect, you know, the effect of mimicry on the likelihood to come to a deal was actually operating through seller trust. So the mimicry affected seller trust, which then affected whether they came to a deal.
Okay, back to me. So Karina has been talking about the ways that mimicry can influence affective forms of prosociality. So now we're going to turn to the ways in which mimicry can influence more cognitive forms of prosociality. So I'll talk about three of these. So mimicry influences perceived similarity between people. It can influence or lead to what we're going to call self-other merging, which I'll talk about in a minute, and interdependent self-control. So these are kind of three ways in which mimicry influences cognitive prosociality. Okay, so first, mimicry facilitates feelings of similarity. So people who are mimicked feel more similar to the person who mimicked them, for example. This is a study where people will converge on their evaluations of things, for example, movies. So if people are watching a movie together and I'm sitting next to Karina, let's say in a movie theater, if we are able to see each other, we will end up having a very similar evaluation of the movie without even talking about it, without saying a word. We will end up having a similar evaluation of that movie. Presumably because we can see each other and kind of are picking up on and probably mimicking each other's reactions to the movie. So people end up converging in terms of their evaluations and becoming more similar in their evaluations of their experiences if they're allowed to mimic each other. So then this is a project with Pontus Leander where what we're arguing is that mimicry can lead to this self-other merging. And in fact, you end up kind of confusing. If someone's mimicking you, you may end up confusing their attributes as your own attributes. You may think that they're your own attributes because you're perceiving them in someone else. So I'll talk a little bit more about this. So this is the paradigm for this project. So basically, people are mimicked or not, and Karina was talking about how this is done in the lab, and you saw that little video. So same paradigm here, where there's a confederate who is, who's mimicking or not. And then what we do is we manipulate some sort of characteristic in the Confederate. So we manipulate some sort of attribute. So I say attribute because it's pretty vague. We did it with goals. We did it with emotions. We did it with like personality traits. So some sort of characteristic or attribute is manipulated in the Confederate. So the Confederate is acting one way or another. And then we measure that attribute in the participant. And this is crossed with whether the Confederate is mimicking the participant or not. So we're crossing that. So in this one study, that I'll just give you an example, the attribute we manipulated was outspokenness. So it's kind of a trait of outspokenness. So the way we operationalized that in this particular study was that the Confederate was wearing a black t-shirt that was either plain or that said equality on it. And this has been used as a manipulation of outspokenness in some other studies. So this this isn't our manipulation, but we took this from some other literature. So we had this manipulated, and then we crossed that with whether the Confederate wearing one of these two shirts either mimicked the participant or not. And then we actually measure participant outspokenness. Now this is self-report, so how outspoken the participants think they are. And the idea is if they're being mimicked, they may sort of take on this trait that they're perceiving in the other person and think that it's their own and then report themselves as being more. Yeah, okay, thanks. So what we have here are the results. And if you look, so first look at just the no mimicry bars just for a second. On the y-axis, we have outspokenness ratings of the participants. So if they're not being mimicked, what you actually get is that people who are with a low outspokenness person tend to rate themselves, if anything, a little bit more outspoken than if they're with the high outspokenness person. So in other words, they're kind of complementing. So if there's no mimicry involved, if I'm with someone with a big equality shirt, I'm going to actually perceive myself as being a little bit less outspoken, probably because I'm comparing myself to this person who seems very outspoken. I kind of contrast away from that. And so, you know, okay, I guess I'm not that outspoken, you know, compared to this person. So you kind of get a contrast away from what they're seeing in the other person. But this flips if they're mimicked by that person. So now, if I'm with the outspoken person, I now think that I'm outspoken too. Or if I'm with the lower outspoken person, I don't think I'm as outspoken either. So kind of this self-other merging where I am misattributing their characteristic as my own, but only if they're mimicking me. So we're arguing in this paper, and we do it with, this is with a personality trait, you know, outspokenness, but we also have it with goals, goal states that people have, whether they have an affiliation goal or an achievement goal. We have it with mood states. So we have it with across a different variety of kinds of attributes. And so we're arguing that mimicry can lead to kind of these, what we're calling mirror inferences. So we're inferring what we see in the other person, we're inferring that, and misattributing it as our own traits or qualities or attributes. Okay. So another way that mimicry influences cognitive forms of prosociality is that people will, so I talked about how people's evaluations of experiences will converge, but also people will just take on the opinions, the preferences of other people. Rather than them being formed together in a similar way, if one person has an existing opinion or an existing belief, they'll be more persuasive, and the other person will take on that belief or opinion more if they're mimicked by them. So in one study looking at this, this is looking at consumption. Again, we have a mimicry condition where there's a Confederate and a participant, and then an anti-mimicry condition in this case, where anti-mimicry in this case just means that they're making sure that they're actively doing something other than what the participant is doing. So instead of just sitting there in a neutral position, you know, if the person is, you know, crossing their leg, they'll make sure that they're not crossing their leg. But if they're not crossing their leg, they'll make sure that they are crossing their leg. So they make sure that they are sitting in a different way and have different mannerisms and gestures and postures than the participant. But it's basically a control condition. And then they're told by the, so the Confederate in this case is telling them about a new product that's gonna be launched. It's a new sports drink that hasn't been, isn't on the market right now, but they're doing market research on it, and that's why people are in the lab to kind of test this new potential product that may be introduced. And so the Confederate puts a picture of this drink in front of them and says, so we really like your opinion on this. So you can try as much or as little as you want of this sports drink. And then we'll ask you some questions about it. So our DVs were, you know, how much they actually drank of this drink, and then how much they enjoyed it, whether they said they'd be likely to buy it if it was on the market, whether they thought it was going to be successful, and so on. And what we found is that people who were mimicked, so this is the results for the, people who were mimicked, all of these things were influenced. So if they were mimicked, they liked it more. They said they're more likely to buy it. They thought it was going to be successful, and then they also drank more of it. So, you know, and if they were just kind of saying, oh yeah, sure, it's going to be great, that'd be one thing. But they actually drank a lot more of it. So they did seem to really like it more and take on the opinion of the Confederate, but only if they were mimicked by that person. And in a follow-up study, we wanted to see, well, is this really pro-sociality? So what we did in this case is this facilitator, the Confederate, who was mimicking or not, we also manipulated whether she, or actually it was a he in this study, whether he seemed invested in the success of this product that might be launched, or was like a neutral third party and didn't care. So when the participant came in, the facilitator, the Confederate, said, we are thinking, we're doing some market research and testing some new cheese straws that are going to be influenced or maybe introduced in the marketplace. And cheese straws, they actually are available in some places, but most subjects hadn't heard of them and didn't know what they were or that they existed. They're pretty good. If you haven't tried them, you should try them. So she either or he either said in this study, just so you know, I work for the cheese straw company, and if it does really well, that means I'm going to do well, and so I'm really hoping that people like these cheese straws. Kind of like, help me out. I'm invested in the success of this product, of these cheese straws. So that's the invested condition. The independent condition. He said, just so you know, I'm working for an independent research firm. We're testing these cheese straws. I've got no horses in this race kind of thing. It doesn't matter to me. And made it clear that he was very independent and didn't matter to him what they thought of the cheese straws. And that was crossed with mimicry. And then what we looked at, same kind of thing, how much of the cheese straws they ate, likelihood of success, and so on. And what we found, which I think was interesting, is that mimicry did lead to more likelihood to buy, more enjoyment of the product, and so on, but only if the person was invested, or at least more so if the person was invested. So you might think if the person is invested, you might get a backfiring effect, like, oh, please like these cheese straws. I really want you to like this. People might go, oh, no. But what actually happened is that if they were mimicked, they really tried to help that person out, even if they were, and I will say he was a very likable person. You can imagine maybe an obnoxious salesperson, you might get a different effect than we got here. He was likable, but he was clearly invested, clearly kind of wanting help. And so if he mimicked them, they helped more in the sense that they ate more, they liked it more, and so on. Okay. The third thing I'll talk about is interdependent self-control. So I know a lot of you are very familiar with this. For those of you who aren't, self-control is the extent to which the identity of the self is construed in relation to other people. So do I think of myself as kind of an independent entity, or do I think of myself in relation to others? And so it can range from independent on the one end to very interdependent on the other end. And it's a continuum. And so we wanted to see whether mimicry influences sort of people's sense of self and the extent to which it's kind of embedded with other people versus independent. And what's been found, and actually not just by us, but by some other people in other labs also, is that, so that mimicry, people who are mimicked feel more interdependent and have a more interdependent self-control. But interestingly, mimicking someone else also makes you feel more interdependent. So it's not just you as the person being mimicked now feels more interdependent, but if you are actually told to mimic someone else, and so you do so, you will actually also feel more interdependent and connected as the actor, as the mimicker. Okay. So one way of measuring this is this kind of circle test that some of you have probably seen, the inclusion of other in the self scale. So people were mimicked or not, and then just asked to circle one of these. And the way it was phrased is, how close do you feel to other people in general? So they would circle one of these figures, how close they feel to other people in general. And the idea is, if they're feeling very independent, their self-control is very independent, you know, this is, I feel completely separate from other people, all the way to, you know, I am one with others, you know, I'm very close, feel very close to others. And so what we found, people are more likely to kind of be on this end of the spectrum and say, I feel very close, you know, very overlapping self and other figure. They're more likely to circle these if they were just mimicked than if they weren't just mimicked. So, and now we're gonna show another quick part of this video.
If you could have a seat here anywhere you'd like, and then Amy, I will put you in this room, and then I'll be back in a minute.
Now, see where he sits. This is all for stuff.
I don't know what this is yet. I think they're trying to find something in my brain.
Well, what we wanted to see was where you sat. We wanted to see if you sat close to the one that has the backpack and the sweater on it, yeah, or if you sat further away from that.
So the seating distance is another measure of feeling close to other people. And so the seating distance is another way to measure how close people are feeling to others. And if there's stuff, you know, on a seat, someone's clearly sitting there, do you sit like in the furthest possible away from that, or do you sit relatively near where the other person's sitting? We also, in some follow-up work, looked to see whether that influences prosociality and found that it did. So prosociality, the way we looked at it here, was helping behavior. Things like, if I drop a bunch of pens in front of you, are you gonna help me pick them up? Or are you gonna go, oh, too bad, you know, and let me pick them up all myself? So people who are more pro-social, more helping, picking up the pens and so on, that was our DV here, there, is to see how much they helped with the pens. And what we found is that people who were mimicked helped pick up more pens. And that seemed to be mediated by, or driven really by, this interdependent self-control being activated. So people feel closer to others. Remember the circles, like self-other merging. People are feeling closer to other people. And that leads them to help more if they need help, if they drop pens in this case. Oh, is it you? Okay.
Okay, so this next section is on how mimicry facilitates the understanding and experience of others' emotions. And for this section, since we're talking mostly about empathy and related processes, we've combined the affective and cognitive components of prosociality just to address this specific section. And so the topics that we're going to be covering are things like emotion perception, so how we understand others' emotions, emotional contagion, how we take on others' emotions, and empathy, and how empathy affects, how mimicry affects empathy, and how that leads to a reduction in prejudice, victim blaming, and enhanced empathy for pain. So how do we recognize the emotions that other people are experiencing? So one way may be through facial feedback signals, which are generated when we automatically mimic the expressions that we observe in others. And facial feedback signals could then be processed in the brain to then help facilitate emotion recognition. And so blocking these signals by blocking mimicry does lead to slower and less accurate emotion perception. So one study that looked at this recruited people who had received either Botox or a dermal filler, and Both of these are cosmetic procedures, but for Botox, it works to reduce the appearance of wrinkles by actually paralyzing the muscles around the face, and the other one doesn't paralyze the muscles. So this was kind of a good test group to see how if people couldn't use their facial muscles, whether that would lead to less accuracy in perceiving others' emotions. So how they did this is through a classic test called the Reading the Mind and the Eyes test, which measures emotion perception accuracy. So I'm gonna have you guys play along, see how you do. All right, so here's what they would see. They would see a face and then four options. So I'm gonna give you guys two choices. Raise your hand for which one you like.
You guys are good.
Okay, all right, so regretful or terrified? So who thinks it's regretful? Okay, and who thinks it's terrified? All right, you guys are doing really well. I feel like there's a selection bias for this field. Okay, so we'll go to the next one quickly, but just think to yourself whether you got it right or not. So this one's desire. All right, and this one is defiant. Okay, so if you got 4 out of 4 right, you're doing better than average. If you got 3 right, then you're right there with the control group. Good job. This is what the dermal filler group did. And if you got less than that, then you might have gotten Botox. So so those who were prevented from mimicking facial expressions due to Botox injections paralyzing the facial muscles actually were less accurate at predicting emotions in photographs. And so also restricting muscle movements, so blocking specific muscle movements, impairs the recognition of corresponding emotions. So for example, if the muscle movements in the lower half of the face are restricted, then people are less accurate at recognizing happiness and disgust. But if the muscle movements are blocked in the upper half of the face, then they're less accurate at recognizing anger. And so it was suggested that, you know, if blocking mimicry, you know, leads to a reduction in emotion perception, you know, maybe via these facial feedback signals being blocked, then amplifying these signals should improve emotion perception. And so what they did was they kind of put this mask on people's faces. If you've ever had one before, like a mud mask, you'll know what I'm talking about, that when you kind of move your muscles a little bit, you can feel everything moving. If you haven't received this, just take my word for it. It really amplifies the facial feedback signals. And so what this did was that when people would wear this, you know, gel mask, they actually had improved emotion perception. So it kind of further suggested that these facial feedback signals are important for this. And so mimicry, so true smiles are mimicked more than false smiles. The difference between a true smile and a false smile is that true smiles really involve the muscles in the eyes and the mouth. The muscles pull the lips upward, kind of creating lines between the nose and the mouth, and then the eyes squint with a true smile as well. So it's been found that facial mimicry might help us distinguish between subtle emotions, such as true versus false smiles. And so how this study worked was they brought people into the lab and they put them in 3 conditions. So they're, you know, randomly split to 3 groups. In the free mimicry condition, people were just allowed to mimic freely as they would. They weren't told anything specific. In the blocked mimicry condition, participants were told that bodily movements interfered with the task, and that for this reason they were given a sports mouth guard to wear to stabilize their facial muscles. But then it was kind of hypothesized that, well, this is like really distracting, like if they perform more poorly, maybe it's not about the fact that they couldn't mimic, but just about like the giant sports mouth guard in their mouth being distracting. So they also included a distraction control to rule out this possibility. So in the distraction control, participants were told the same information about bodily movements interfering with the task, and they were given a stress ball to hold firmly in their non-dominant hand throughout the task. And so this is just kind of a little preview of the types of things that they saw. This is an exact stimuli, but participants were asked to rate the genuineness of true versus false smiles, 1 being not genuine at all to 5 being very genuine. And these are, you know, the types of stimuli that they saw, and I was just gonna have you guys look at these pairs of faces. One's a true smile, one's a false smile, and just see how you do at distinguishing them. So go ahead and try to pick the pair, pick one in each pair that you think is the true smile. Okay, all right. So how'd you guys do? Probably pretty good. It's 9 a.m., probably awesome. Okay, so the results reveal that people who are allowed to freely mimic do outperform those who are wearing a sports mouth guard and whose mimicry is blocked. But more importantly, it's not just about, you know, those people wearing the sports mouth guard being distracted by it. It's actually that those people who were holding the stress ball still outperformed those who had the sports mouth guard. So it looks like mimicry really does help us distinguish between true and false smiles. And so far we've been talking about how mimicry helps us understand others' emotions, but mimicry also helps us experience others' emotions, and this process is called emotional contagion. So a few studies on that. So one study subliminally primed people with happy versus angry facial expressions. So this means that the faces happened so quickly they didn't actually consciously register them, but things can still get through in non-conscious ways. So they saw a bunch of these faces, they didn't consciously realize they saw the faces. Half of the participants were allowed to mimic, half weren't, because they were wearing, you know, it wasn't a sports mouth guard, but their facial movements were blocked. And for those who were subliminally primed with happy expressions, this led to more positive judgments of a cartoon, so they rated it as funnier, but only if they were able to mimic. So meaning that they're able to mimic, so meaning that when, you know, facial muscles are not blocked and they're able to mimic, that this leads them to think this is funny, more funny. And it's thought that emotional contagion facilitates this effect. And furthermore, when participants are read a speech in a happy tone, they report being in a better mood than when they're read a speech in a sad tone. And also, mimicking others leads people to report their own cognitive empathy as being higher. So people are instructed to mimic or not mimic the facial expressions of others, and then afterward they reported on their cognitive empathy. And this was actually operationalized as perspective taking, and this picture kind of perfectly captures what perspective taking is. So these men are arguing about whether it's a 6 or a 9, but if they had better perspective taking skills, they would recognize that they're actually both right. And so people who mimic are better at this type of thing. So mimicry also reduces prejudice. So non-black undergraduate students were brought into the lab and they were put in one of three conditions. So in the outgroup mimicry condition, what they saw was black actors reaching for a glass of water, taking a sip of the water, and then putting the glass back down, and they were just told to match the actor's movements as they watched it on the film. And to make sure that it's not just about mimicry in general, if, you know, mimicry reduces prejudice, is it specifically about mimicking an out-group, or is it any kind of mimicry? Can you mimic an in-group and then have reduced prejudice? They also had an in-group mimicry condition where they watched the same video but with in-group members, and they mimicked them instead. And you know, if there was also the possibility that it's just observing the out-group that leads to reduction in bias, and so to control for this possibility, they had them watch the same video of the black actors reaching for the glass of water, but they did not mimic in this case. So then what they had them do is they measured implicit anti-black prejudice using the affect misattribution paradigm, which is in this lower half of the screen. And so how this works is that they quickly see a face flashed on the screen, 75 milliseconds, very quick, and then they see an unfamiliar pictogram. And they're just asked to, you know, ignore the face that they saw before and just tell whether they think that the pictogram is pleasant or unpleasant. And so the idea behind this is that if there's any negative affect from seeing the black face, that this should kind of spill over to the pictogram, even though they're told to ignore it, and that they should then report the pictograms associated with black faces as more unpleasant. And so what we see is in the in-group mimicry condition and the out-group observation condition, this is the case. They do report that the black faces are more, that the pictograms associated with the black faces are more unpleasant. But when they mimic an out-group member, there's actually then no difference between how they rate pictograms associated with white versus black faces. So in the out-group mimicry condition only, there's a similar preference for blacks as there is for whites. And that mimicking black people reduces bias over and above simply observing black people or mimicking other people in general. And there was one other way that they measure this, and this was through kind of an explicit measure, so that one was just implicit. But they just, you know, asked people their opinions on things, and they asked them to rate the extent to which they agreed with these types of statements. So how much of the racial tension that exists in the United States today do you think blacks are responsible for creating? And they just asked them to say how much they agreed with that statement and other statements like it. And what they find is that there's a significant difference between in-group mimicry, the in-group mimicry condition, and the out-group mimicry condition, such that mimicking the out-group reduces conscious reports of prejudice. And mimicry also reduces victim blaming. So how this worked was participants watched a video of someone talking about their art history class, and they were told to either mimic the person or not mimic. And so in both conditions, Yeah, so so then later they read about somebody who was a victim of a crime, and they found out that that person had either been the same person that they had mimicked or a different person. And then victim blaming was measured. And so then what it showed was that there's a significant main effect of mimicry. So it didn't matter whether they mimicked the victim or the non-victim. The result was the same, that mimicry reduced victim blaming. And importantly, mimicry did not cause them to reduce perpetrator blaming. So the authors speculated that the effects of mimicry are specific to people with whom we can easily empathize with, such as victims. And I'm just going to skip over these next slides since we're running out of time.
Okay. Okay, so now we've talked about the affective and cognitive components of prosociality. So just turning to the behavioral piece, mimicry has been found to increase helping behavior. So dyad meaning here, the mimicry dyad. So the person mimicking and the person being mimicked would be that dyad. And so this, it leads to prosociality, helping behavior within the dyad, but actually beyond the dyad, which I'll talk about in a minute, and even with high cost. So within the dyad leads to helping behavior. So in some research where mimicry was manipulated, so mimicked people were mimicked or not, Van Baron et al. Found that people who were mimicked leave larger tips in restaurants, kind of interesting. Also, in a separate paper, found out that that people who were mimicked helped pick up more dropped items. So kind of the pen thing where a bunch of pens are accidentally dropped, and then you see how much the participant helps the Confederate pick them up. If they were mimicked by that person, they helped them pick up more pens. But interestingly, this effect even spread beyond the dyad. So if Karina mimics me, not only am I more likely to help her if she drops some pens, but I'm more likely to help Eric if he drops pens. And he's not the one that mimicked me. But it kind of, it generalizes beyond the mimicry dyad. So for example, more likely to help a stranded person, more likely to give money to charity, so kind of a general, you know, other people in general, and more likely to volunteer to fill out a tedious survey. So more likely to help others, not just the person who mimicked you, but you just become more pro-social in general. So this is a video, this is the pen one, right? Yeah, okay. So this is the pen drop.
CFA does that. Scratch.
Well, my concern about camera shots may have one time this experiment with me. Being mimicked not only makes most of her subjects feel better about the person doing the mimicking, but also makes them better persons themselves. In one of the experiments, in other trials, the subject is purposely not mimicked. In fact, is anti-mimicked.
To the extent that unconsciously he knows he's given her a chance to mimic him and she does something
right.
Totally different.
That's right.
That must
rejection.
Really,
yeah, right.
Must really
that's right.
Personal.
It really does. And that's why we found, I think, that people who are anti-mimicked, it's so disruptive to what the normal social interaction is supposed to be that we find that they have less self-control, less ability to regulate their behavior on a later time.
When I go home, I need to say to my wife, I need a drink and a lot of mimicry.
So in a recent study, well, a couple years ago now, they wanted to really test the boundaries of this. Like, okay, how far can we push this? Picking up pens, big deal. It's helpful, but it doesn't cost the person much to reach down and pick up a few pens. But let's really see, you know, if it's costly and they're probably not gonna wanna help, will mimicry actually help with something that's more substantive? So in this study, they looked to see whether being mimicked leads to more helping, even when the cost is really high. So the paradigm they used is experimenter came up and asked a pedestrian, you know, someone on the street for directions to the train station. And then while the person was giving them directions, The experimenter either mimicked them or anti-mimicked or control while the person who's giving them the directions. Then they said, you know what, this is kind of confusing. Would you mind just walking me to the train station? So it was about a 15-minute walk. So like a mile. So, you know, to actually do this would be extremely, I mean, it's very costly and it would be very helpful and very nice, but they just kind of say, oh, I'm just so confused, can you help me out? And then so what they looked at was the likelihood of helping and walking them 15 minutes to the train station. And what they found is that this is the number of people who helped and the number of people who didn't help. So these are just number of participants here. So you can see in the control condition, most people did not help here, and only a few people helped in the control condition. Although, you know, like four people actually did that in the control, which was pretty impressive. With the mimicry condition, if they were mimicked, you can see that people, most people actually helped and walked them. And this is just like a 3-minute thing where, you know, Eric's giving me directions, and in the time it takes him to give me the directions, 2 minutes or something, I'm mimicking him or not. That's it. And that led people to be much more likely to actually walk 15 minutes to help this person out. Anti-mimicry, interestingly, you know, you might think that it'd be more extreme than the control. I don't think this is significantly different from this, but you know, it is what it is. It could be that anti-mimicry, at least you're kind of responding to what they're doing in some way, even though it's not taking on the same gestures and manners, you're still sort of responding to them in some, that could be why maybe it leads to a little bit more helping behavior than in the control condition. So even when really costly, people still are more likely to help. Okay, so this is what we've been talking about, this conceptual model that mimicry leads to these different types of prosociality, which then have been shown to really be a part of and lead to morality. And so I think how are we on time? Over. Okay, we're good. So I'll just quickly, you're sort of over. Okay. That really all of this is through prosocial behavior, and that the affective piece, trusting others, leads to more prosocial behavior. So that's been found. The cognitive piece, having empathy for others, having interdependent self-construal, also leads to more helpful behavior. And that those in turn, helpful behavior, you know, is kind of one form of morality. So that's kind of our big picture, that we think mimicry does influence morality, even though it's this unconscious, automatic, nonverbal behavior that we engage in. So thank you. Sorry, we went over.
That's fine. So we have 20 minutes or so for a question and answer. I'll call on people who mimic me. Yeah, Jeff.
Well, thanks for the talk. I thought that was really interesting. I guess I want to hear more about your thoughts about the link between prosociality and morality or overall goodness. Because it seems to me it could be that prosociality leads to things that we regard as morally good, but there do seem to be cases where that's going to break down. And so when you were giving the example of the person where you're mimicking a black person, I immediately thought, well, what if you're mimicking a white supremacist? Or somebody whose moral values we don't think are of as being good on the whole. Your perspective imply that you're going to sort of take on the perspective of that person? And I guess the other side of this would be, there do seem to be cases where being nice and being pro-social is not the thing that we would want, all things considered. For instance, in cases where the morally right thing to do is be honest rather than be nice. Tell somebody they don't want to hear, but that's ultimately beneficial. So I guess I'm just curious about what you think of it as the link between those two constructs in the model.
Yeah, I think that's really interesting. And in all of these studies, the work that we've been talking about, mimicry is leading to kind of a general tendency to be pro-social towards other people. But you're pointing out, first of all, that may not always be, you know, you may want honesty over kind of niceness in some cases. I would completely agree with that, and I think that'd be really interesting to look and see how mimicry can maybe get you in trouble. And instead of telling someone they don't want to hear or something that's unpleasant, that mimicry makes them more likely to do that rather than be honest and kind of help them in that way. Because helping doesn't necessarily always mean just being super, you know, nice to them. So that would be a really neat study, I think, because you could actually look at that and see, look at these situations where honesty would be more helpful than niceness and see, does mimicry lead to just more niceness or might it lead to more honesty in some cases? I don't know. It'd be interesting to look at that. And in the case of mimicking someone who's not very moral or ethical, that's another interesting boundary condition that we haven't looked at all that I think would be really interesting because you're right, if you're mimicking someone who you know their attitude, we know that attitudes, evaluations, and attitudes and opinions converge and people become more similar. So especially if you're interacting with someone like that more than once and on a regular basis, you're mimicking maybe their facial expressions, you're mimicking their gestures, their mannerisms, that might lead you to converge and might lead to kind of, now maybe you're more pro-social toward that person, but you know, in general, you may take on their kind of amoral opinion. So I also think that'd be a really interesting boundary condition to explore that we haven't looked at yet. Yeah, it's cool, it's interesting.
Yeah, I mean, you could also look at teenagers and peer pressure. We don't always want
our teens to
behave like their peers. I have a sort of technical question about these experiments. Given that you're looking at something that we typically aren't aware of doing and we're typically not aware of the effects it's having, I'm worried about your confederates a little bit because in the mimicry condition, presumably, in addition to mimicking, that may be causing other things that neither you nor they are aware of. And I don't even know what they would be, but they, you know, automatic behavioral changes or emotional changes, and those changes might be driving some of the effects. So I'm wondering if you have any control for whether in mimicking or anti-mimicking, you're getting sort of spillover effects.
Yeah, you know, it's a really good point that if the Confederates are told to mimic this other person, and that's all they're told, you know, okay, mimic or not mimic, that the people who are told to mimic may be doing other things in addition to just mimicking them, and it's those other things that may be contributing to some of these downstream consequences for prosociality. In the first few studies and papers that we published on mimicry, the reviewers were saying that too, and it was a really good point. And so what we ended up doing is videotaping the interactions and then coding for things like eye contact, how much are they smiling, how much, like they're seating, you know, direct, are they sitting more towards the person or away, all these other kinds of automatic things that they may be doing in addition, because we had to rule out that that's what was driving the effects. And we don't do it every time anymore, but we did do it, you know, in the first few papers, you know, we needed to show that and document that it really was the mimicry and not just more smiling or more. And the Confederates now are trained it's kind of a rigorous training procedure that they go through that kind of controls for a lot of this. And it takes a while for them to really isolate just the mimicry and not have all these other things.
And the thing that they're isolating is just bodily position?
Usually in this, sometimes we're doing verbal mimicry, but in most of the studies that we do, it's just isolating the motor movements, so posture, mannerisms, and gestures.
Mm-hmm. Right. I just want to ask you whether you've given any thought to the possible educational implications of your findings. So I belong to a group of academics who are designing teaching materials for first-year students in medicine, law, and teaching. Should I go back now after listening to your findings and say, well, let's include, you know, cultivating mimicry as part of the ethical training of these professions because it's good for them to mimic, you know, the facial expressions, etc., other students, patients, clients. I mean, I would be worried about things like authenticity and manipulation, which would kind of offset the moral benefits of this. It's a bit like spontaneity. I mean, it's one of those things which is a good thing to have, but you can't really cultivate it because it would be psychologically or morally self-defeating in a way. You can't cultivate spontaneity.
So, it's funny because about 2 weeks ago I had the director for our psychiatry program at Duke say, can I set up a meeting? And I didn't know what the meeting was going to be about. And then he sat in my office and said, so, you know, I'm in charge of all the new med students who go into psychiatry, and I want to have a whole training session on teaching them how to mimic their clients, their patients. So exactly what you're saying in terms of education and how do I teach them how to mimic their clients. And so, you know, it like my interest in mimicry started out as looking at how it was automatic and unconscious and something that's natural and isn't something that you're planning or thinking about doing. but our paradigm, you know, involves teaching Confederates how to mimic participants, which of course isn't, you know, automatic and unconscious, and they're doing it very intentionally. So we try to simulate what happens, you know, in real life. The big thing is everything that I just talked about, all these effects on prosociality, all that goes away if the person realizes either that they're being mimicked or even just noticing that they have the same, they're sitting the same way, they have the same gesture, they have the same mannerisms. If they notice that, everything goes away. So these prosocial effects. Presumably people don't like want to think that someone's mimicking them. They don't like the idea of that. They don't even like the idea of that they're mimicking someone else. That's kind of, they try to stop mimicking other people. And even if you just point out, oh, look, you guys are sitting the same way, that's very aversive to people. For whatever reason. So all of this has to remain, you know, below the radar. It can't be brought to conscious attention where people actually realize that mimicry is happening. So when we train our Confederates to mimic, that's our big concern, is that it's the participants will notice that they're being mimicked. So what we do is we have them wait a few seconds. So I know there's a big research literature on synchrony, which is like moment by moment, you know, coordination of action. But with mimicry, it doesn't have to be at the exact same moment. So if Walter, you know, touches his head here, I don't have to touch mine at the exact same moment, you know, there can be like a 3-second delay and you'll get all these consequences. So we train Confederates to wait 3 to 5 seconds before mimicking. And we also tell them to do slight variations. So if he touches his ear, I might touch the top of my head. So it's not the identical movement. And these are just, the reason we put these things in place is just so that people aren't aware that they're being mimicked. And you still get all these, you know, positive consequences. It's not in sync. It's not perfectly in sync in terms of timing, but it doesn't need to be. We still are kind of doing the same thing, even if it's separated by, you know, it's slightly different, a little variation of it, and if it's, you know, a few seconds after the fact. It's still encoded, at least, it seems, because you know, all the studies have been done that way. So if, like what I told the guy in psychiatry is, if he did want to do this, to make sure that the mimicry goes unnoticed by making it subtle in these ways that we train our Confederates. Now that doesn't address your issue of kind of spontaneity, because even if they do it subtly, it's not spontaneous for them. Now I think, and the research seems to show that the downstream consequences are going to be the same for the person being mimicked. But for the person mimicking, if it's not spontaneous and if it's kind of this, like, okay, now I know I'm doing this, might that affect other parts of the interaction? Might that affect other things? We don't know. And that's very possible.
So let's see. I've seen. Rhonda, did you have, you had a question
earlier? I had a question.
So let's go Aranda, and then let's go Nancy, and then let's go Carl.
So I just had a question about your final study where uh-huh. you had people walk participants or walk Confederates.
Right,
through.
And that wasn't our study, but yeah, right. We described it, yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
Did you were the gender effects there? Like, were people more likely to take Confederates?
Was
there the same gender or cross-gender?
Yeah.
And in general, are the effects, mimicry effects stronger when they're of the same gender, or are there trust issues when they're cross-gender?
That's interesting. So in that study, I think they were underpowered to look at gender effects,
yeah.
Because in each condition there are about 15 to 20 people. So if you break that down, I'm sure they didn't have enough to really look for that. Overall, I think there aren't as many gender effects as you might expect, right, or kind of assume that there would be. Sometimes you'll get a main effect for on the pro-social behavior, like with picking up pens, men will pick up more pens than women do. So there's like a main effect of gender there, but it's not interacting with mimicry. It's not that if mimicked, men particularly respond. Right. It's just a main effect. So sometimes you'll get that main effect. In terms of response to being mimicked, we don't find, and I don't think other people find, you know, a lot of gender differences in that, which is interesting because you might think people do mimic. So, you know, if you have cross-gender interactions, then things like attractiveness come into play. Well, people will mimic an attractive other of the other gender, you know, more, and that's less the case for same gender. So there's some nuances like that, but yeah.
Thank you very much for your presentation. It was fascinating.
Thanks.
I guess I'm interested in the anti-mimicking.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm interested also in what you use for mimicking, anti-mimicking, and controls. In the case of anti-mimicking, the leg crossing example is pretty obvious. But what's an anti-mimicking for touching your ear or touching your head?
Yeah.
And then what were your control conditions? And I raise this question because of the results in the train station study where it seemed that there was a fairly large anti-mimicking group who actually helped in that situation. And then also in the film of the pens, the guy who didn't exactly jump up to pick up the pens, but he did do a little bit of helping behavior in the anti-mimicking condition.
Mm-hmm.
But what would be the control condition for that kind of situation?
Well, so I'll talk more generally first about different controls for mimicry. So in the initial work that we did, our control condition was, so the Confederates were told to either mimic or to not mimic. And the not mimic, what we had them do is sit with their legs uncrossed, posture upright, and hands here on their legs. And they kind of stayed in that position throughout. And that was our control group. But what we started finding, not in that first study, but later, is that when we had that as a control group, participants started mimicking them. And so they would both be sitting like this. And now it's not really a control group anymore because, you know, so we had a problem where this neutral posture and position wasn't an ideal control. So we introduced this idea of anti-mimicry just to get rid of that problem of them sitting there and now the participants mimicking them. So globally, the Confederate is just told, make sure you're not sitting the same way as them at any given time. So they may start out this way, sitting in a neutral position, and if the participant then starts to mimic the Confederate and sits like that too, okay, now I'm going to lean, and now I'm going to touch my head, now I'm going to be moving more. And then if they start doing that, I make sure that I'm, you know, sitting more neutrally again. So it's not that there was a specific anti-mimicry move for like ear touching, but they would make sure that they're not doing. And if the person was fidgety, they make sure that they're kind of calm and still. If the person was leaning to the side, they'd make sure that they were sitting, you know, erect and up. So just making sure that this didn't happen where they ended up sitting the same way in the control condition.
Can I follow up?
Yeah.
I mean, here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking in about the difference between mimicking someone and simply responding to what another person is doing, albeit in a different way.
Right.
And so that anti-mimicking condition, I wonder if that's simply a responsiveness to what another person is doing.
Yeah. Yeah, and I think that's interesting, and that's sort of my take on that last study with the train, walking to the train station, because if you look at the data, but like here, I mean, you are getting more helping than you are with the control, and exactly, that's my guess as to what's going on. And this again isn't my, this isn't my research, but you know, my take on this is that with, you know, anti-mimicry, they are responding in some way, even though they're being responsive, even though they're not doing the same thing, it's still responsive, and that might lead to some more helping behavior, not as much as actually being mimicked, and this is a significant difference. But still, you know, versus the control. And I don't know that these, I don't know what the, again, this is kind of an underpowered study because it was probably pretty hard to run. I'm not sure if this, you know, is significant. I'm not sure exactly which bars are different from others. But I think that's possible. In the synchrony literature, there's this distinction that's made between in-phase and anti-phase synchrony. And in-phase, you know, would be, and usually it's things like tapping or walking. in-phase would be kind of like the mimicry, the same thing at the same time. But anti-phase would be, I'm still in sync with you, but I'm doing the opposite. So if we're tapping and you're going down, I go up. So we'd be doing this instead of this. So this would be anti-phase, this would be in-phase synchrony. And anti-phase, you can get a lot of pro-social benefits from that too, because we're still in sync, we're still responding. So that I agree that that could be what, you know, what's going on here. In general, we find pretty big differences between mimicry and anti-mimicry in terms of a lot of our downstream consequences. So usually there is a significant difference. Now whether, you know, if we also had this in there, whether there'd be a difference here too, you know, there could be. But I agree that kind of responding to the other person, I think, plays a role too.
Yeah, I'm just curious about the implications of this for conflict resolution and peacemaking. I was thinking, you know, my wife got mad at me because I forgot Mother's Day. And if she starts gesticulating or raising her voice, if I mimic her, will it make her upset? Does it work for those sorts of things? Or if I'm in a conflict with someone and there's a mediator present, is it a good idea to try to mimic the person who's...
Yeah. So I'll say, first of all, that there are not many studies that I know of in mimicry that have looked at mimicry of, you know, spouses or significant others or people, like looking at mimicry between married couples, for example. Usually it's strangers. And so you're, because they're trying to isolate, okay, you don't know this person, you have no existing relationship, what kind of effect does mimicry have? Mimicry between people who know each other, who are good friends or spouses or whatever, that's interesting too, and much less has been done on that except for the early work just looking at correlations between mimicry and rapport, like really early on, that was done with people who know each other. But since then, most of the work has been done on strangers. I think, though, in theory, you know, all the work on the negotiations that Karina was talking about, the work on trust and negotiating, that mimicry really does help engender trust, and which then can help to resolving conflicts and coming to a resolution and negotiating more effectively. All that stuff happens because it leads to more trust. Whether that happens if it's also, you know, in the context of a close relationship where all this other stuff's going on, you know, I'm not sure. But in the case, in the research that's been done with the strangers, it certainly did help towards conflict resolution, exactly. But then once you layer on the relationship dynamics, it gets a lot more complicated, I think. And I'm not sure how robust or what the effect size would be of mimicry in that kind of situation, you know, in the midst.
Yeah, I think there's evidence, though, to suggest that if you mimicked her, that at least you would increase in, like, perspective taking, and, like, that it could then have an effect through that. So not necessarily that, you know, she becomes less angry because she now feels more in sync with you, but I think there's evidence to suggest that it could actually shift something about yourself as well.
Yeah, that's true.
Short question or long question?
No, sure.
Perfect.
Just one. I hope short. Just to elaborate on one of the points made at the beginning. So the talk was about how mimicry facilitates pro-social behavior, but I thought some of the mechanisms were just neutral between pro-social and antisocial behavior, at least outside the dyad. So one of them was being mimicked led you to converge and share someone's goals. That was one of them. So if the person's goals are antisocial, I'm going to get rich by trampling on the suckers of the world, and that person is mimicking you, you would take on that goal, which would be antisocial outside the dyad. And I'll bet you there was a lot of mimicry on Wall Street before 2008. And likewise, there was also convergence in beliefs, I think. So a person has antisocial beliefs. So blacks are largely responsible for racial tension. So aren't some of the mechanisms actually just neutral between pro-social and antisocial behavior outside the dyad?
Yes. So yeah, and with like, so what, Jeff, is it? Yeah, so this kind of goes back to Jeff's initial question. Yeah, if you're mimicking someone who's beliefs are antisocial, then, you know, you may end up taking on that, you know, converging in that. I think that's true. I think, you know, so all these things are looking at something in isolation and trying to kind of isolate one piece of it. But I think the one with the goals in particular that you mentioned, so in that study, they interacted with someone, and we had the slide, but we got rid of it. But it was where they were interacting with someone who's like, I'm all about achievement. I don't care about kind of this whole trampling on others. It wasn't put that way, but it's kind of like, you know, whatever to these people. I'm achieving. Versus interacting with someone who was like, oh no, I'm all about other people. I want to affiliate with others. I care about others more than I care about my own personal achievement. And if they were mimicked, they took on the antisocial, you know, they took on that more achieving, less caring about others goal. And they did better on a GRE test. So they actually performed better. They performed better. But they also reported having less empathy, which was interesting because you think in general it makes you more, you know, I should become more empathic if I'm being mimicked overall. But this is a case where, you know, that doesn't always happen because if I'm mimicked by someone who's very achievement oriented, I become more achievement oriented. I actually achieve more, but then I actually become less empathic with other people, which makes me kind of less pro-social. So I think there are interesting twists in this that you guys have both been bringing up, which are really interesting.
All right, we're out of time. We're going to break until 10:30, so have some coffee, do what you need to do, and let's all join together in thanking you.